Okay, I think we'll start. Good morning. So I've written on the board the state where we are. So we still have to finish this proof of the Li-Yang circle theorem. So let me remind you briefly of where we stopped last week. So given a graph G prime with vertex set V prime and edge set E prime, we introduce some polynomial in the variable Z V prime, which is just a collection of complex variables Zi indexed by the element of the vertex set. This is in C V prime. So the polynomial was defined in this way. I will not recall it. It's just written here with these coefficients which had this expression that we saw last week. I will need that later today. And then the way we proved this, we wanted to prove the theorem was by induction the size of the set of edges. So we suppose that we already had under control the set of edge E, and we are adding a new edge B to this set set of edges E, and this edge B had the property that one of its endpoints U was already used as an endpoint by some edge in E, and the other endpoint V was a new endpoint. So inside V, you already had U, but you didn't have V. And then the goal is to prove that in this case, the polynomial, the corresponding polynomial to this quantity here, never vanishes when all the relevant variables have a modulus smaller than one. And that's what we want to prove. And if we do that, then we are done for this proof of the circle theorem. And this we started to do last week by doing a two-step procedure. So the first step was to prove that, okay, instead of adding this edge between a vertex already used and a new vertex V, let's add another edge, which I call B prime, between two new vertices U prime and V. So that was this this first step. And here, using the fact that we already know that the polynomial has no zeros when all the variables have modulus smaller than one for E, and we also know it for a single edge, we were able to show last week that the polynomial in this case never vanishes when all its variables have modulus smaller than one. Okay. So what remains to prove in order to get the statement are the following two claims. The first one, so maybe let me just recall you something. So this polynomial that we got when we were adding this edge B prime, we decomposed it as a sum of four terms, which was the part of the polynomial which involves the product ZU, ZU prime, where U and U prime are these two vertices, the part which only involves ZU, the part that only involves ZU prime, and the part that involves neither ZU nor ZU prime. Okay, we had this splitting into four terms, and then we introduced this new polynomial, which had the same coefficient p hat minus minus as you had here, and same coefficient p hat plus plus as you had here, but only one variable, which is ZU. I mean, the ZU prime has disappeared here. This was called the Asano contraction of the original polynomial. And the first claim is that this Asano contraction of the polynomial is indeed exactly the same thing as the polynomial we're interested in, which is the polynomial where we have added the edge B to the set of edges E. Okay, so that's the first thing I have to prove, that these two things actually indeed coincide. And the second thing I want to prove is that this polynomial, which is here, this Asano contraction of this original polynomial, never vanishes when all its variables have modulus smaller than one. Okay, once I've done both, then I've proved that this guy never vanishes when all the variables have modulus smaller than one. Okay, so let me start with one here. Let's prove one. Okay, so let's write explicitly what are these coefficient p hat, minus minus, plus plus, and so on and so forth. So let me introduce sigma, sigma prime, which are just plus or minus, which will index my different terms. Then we have that p hat sigma prime has the following form. So it's a sum over all x in V tilde. So V tilde was the set of all variables except U and U prime. Okay. And then we had something that I will call A E union B prime sigma prime of x that I will write down explicitly in a second, and then product over all I in x zi. Okay. So if you compare this with the original polynomial, which is written, the general form is written here, so it's completely similar, but since in this decomposition they've already taken out the effect of the variable zu and zu prime, I don't want them to appear here anymore, so the set x that appears here is only a subset of the remaining variables, and then I have to take into account all the variables, those in x and the zu and the zu prime when relevant, in these coefficients which are here. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to write down explicitly all these coefficients, I mean not all of them, two of them at least, I will write down explicitly, because that's the way we are going to prove this identity. It's by identifying these coefficients. So let's see already a minus minus, e union b prime of x. So in this case, remember that when you have minus minus, it's when both zu and zu prime are present, so it corresponds to the case when u and u prime are selected in the set x, in this original decomposition. So we have u here, u prime there, v, this edge b prime, that's the set E, and we take both, maybe I change color, I could take this, we take both u and u prime are both in x, for this term, I mean in the set of vertices for which the set of vertices which appear in this x here. So what we get is the following. So we will get exactly the original u b prime. If you look at the definition of this set, this coefficient AE, you have to take the product over all edges in E prime, over the relevant edges, such that one of the endpoints is in X and the other endpoint is not in X of this coefficient E minus 2 beta. Now, here, I can first look at what happens for the edges in E, so I'm looking at everything that happens here, so it's just the coefficient AE, but evaluated that. Well, x, which is the subset of all the edges in E but u, but with v, so everything but u and u prime, that's the set x. And I have to add u because u is in the set of vertices at which I have a minus spin. So here I have to add u to this guy. But then I've taken into account only the edges which are inside this set E. I still have to take into account the edge b prime. So I have to multiply this by two possibilities. Either B prime contributes to the coefficient AE, which means that one of its endpoints is in the set of vertices with minus spin, and the other is in the set of vertices with plus spins, or not. So here I already know that the endpoint U prime is in the set of spins with minus sign. So the only way I can get a contribution from the edge B prime, a non-trivial contribution from the edge B prime, is when V is not inside this set. So I will get a factor E minus 2 beta when V does not belong to X. Okay? If not, I get just a factor of 1. So that's when V is in X. Okay? So this gives you an explicit expression for this AE minus minus. I can do the same thing for plus plus. Plus plus is when both u and u prime contain plus spins. So they are, the picture would be like that. So I don't take neither u nor u prime in my set of minus spins. So I get a plus plus e union b prime of x will just be, so I first take only into account the edges which are in e. So I get a e of x. This time I don't have to add u because u has not been taken, times. Now I get a contribution from the edge B prime if I've taken V here inside the set. So I will get a factor E minus 2 beta indicator that V is in X. And I get otherwise just a factor of 1 if V is not in X. Okay, the opposite to what we had before, because now U prime is not, the spin attached to U prime is a plus spin, not a minus spin. So you get a value like that. Okay, of course I could do the same for minus plus and plus minus. A plus minus. You can compute them if you want, similar expression as those two. They are written in the book. I will not have any use of them now, so I will not do it. What I will do instead is the following. So I'm going to look at this this polynomial, the one I'm really interested in, and I'm going to do the same type of decomposition as we did here. So similarly, if I'm looking at the polynomial p hat e union b of, say, zv, z small v, this I can decompose according to whether zu, the vertex u, is in the set x or not. So I get a p hat minus zu plus p hat plus. Okay, here it's contribution of all the set of all the configuration, if you want, in which u, the spin at u is a minus spin, and here it's the contribution from all the configuration in which it's a plus spin. Okay, so I do this same decomposition, and then I can write p hat minus and p hat plus exactly as we did above. So I get that p hat sigma takes the following form. It's a sum over all x in v tilde, so all the edges in v except the vertex u, all the vertices in v except the vertex u, but together with the vertex u, v, small v. So we get this a e union b sigma of x, and then product over I in x, zi. Exactly the same kind of things we had here for in the other case. And now I have to compute this coefficient, then I will be able to compare the coefficients. So let me write it here. So okay, so now the picture is as follows. So I have u, then I have v. I'm now adding this edge b. Okay. And the first term, when I take a minus, that's when I'm putting a minus spin at u. So I have a minus. How did I write it? E union B of X. Proceeding exactly as before, I first look at all the edges which are inside E, so I get AE of X union U. Again, because U, I have a minus spin at U, so I have to add it to the set of all minus spins. And then I have a product with, well, I have to see whether I get the contribution or not from this edge. So I get the contribution from this edge when V has a plus spin, because I already have a minus spin here. So I get E minus 2 beta if V is not in X. Otherwise, I get 1. Okay. And then I do the same for the last term. So I have my U, my V, B, and now U is not inside the set of minus spins, so I get A plus E union B of X, which is A E of X times, and the contribution, this time I get the contribution when V is in X, because U is not, so I get E minus 2 beta, indicator that V is in X, plus indicator that V is not in X. Okay, we are done, because now the only thing that we have to do is to compare this coefficient a minus minus with the coefficient a minus, and the coefficient a plus plus with the coefficient a plus, and see that they coincide, because then this will show that I can replace p hat minus here by p hat minus minus, and this p hat plus by p hat plus plus, which will prove what we want. So let's just first check. So if you compare the two expressions here, you see that they are exactly the same. So you immediately see that a sigma sigma e union b prime of x, it's the same thing as a sigma e union b of x, which implies that, now you look at the expression for this guy and for this guy, this implies immediately that p hat sigma sigma is actually equal, p hat sigma sigma is actually equal to p hat sigma, which implies that the polynomial we're interested in, which is this p hat e union b of zv, z small v, which was decomposed it's here as p hat minus zu plus p hat plus. I can write it as p hat minus minus zu plus p hat plus plus. And this concludes the proof of this first statement here. Just checking that the definitions are indeed giving you what you want. Okay. So the more interesting part is the second statement, which is here, which I'm going to prove now. So let's do it. Two. So as I said last week, what we are going to do is we are going to freeze all the variables except zu and zu prime. So fix zi smaller than one in modulus for all I in v tilde, okay, which is all the vertices except u and u prime. Then we know, that's what we did last week, we know that the original polynomial and the one where I was adding this virtual edge b prime, which was the polynomial p hat minus zu zu prime plus p hat minus plus zu plus p hat plus minus zu prime plus p hat plus plus, this polynomial never vanishes when both zu and zu prime have modulus smaller than 1. Because when this is the case, I have that all my variables have modulus smaller than 1 because all the other ones have already been fixed to some modulus smaller than 1. In this case, the polynomial we proved last week does not vanish. Okay? So this is what we know. Okay? And now what we want to prove is what is written here. So I will not repeat it, it's still there, you can see it. Okay? I want to deduce from the fact that this polynomial does not vanish when zu and zu prime have modulus smaller than 1, the fact that this polynomial does not vanish when zu has modulus smaller than 1. So let's do it. So from this, I can deduce the following. I take a particular case of this result when zu is equal to zu prime is equal to some complex variable z. So I have that p hat minus minus z square plus p hat minus plus plus p hat plus minus z plus p hat plus plus. This never vanishes when z has modulus smaller than 1. It's just a particular case of this one where these two variables actually coincide. Okay. So I know that. But what does this tell me? It tells me that this seen as a polynomial in Z, all the other variables are fixed, so these aren't just numbers, so I have a polynomial in Z. As a polynomial in Z, it's a second degree polynomial in Z, we know that it has two roots. So the two roots of this polynomial let's call them Z plus and Z minus necessarily, they satisfy the fact that the modulus of z plus and the modulus of z minus are larger than 1. Okay, because it has no root. This polynomial has no roots with modulus smaller than 1, which means that its two roots must have a modulus larger than 1. Okay, so that's what we know. But if its two roots have modulus larger than 1, the modulus of their product is also larger than 1. So this implies that the modulus of the product z plus z minus is at least 1. Okay. But it's a second degree polynomial. We know how to express the modulus, we know how to express the product of the roots in terms of the coefficients of the polynomial. Okay, so this is just p hat plus plus over p hat minus minus. Okay? It's the product of the roots of a second degree polynomial. So from this, we deduce that the modulus of p hat plus plus over p hat minus minus is at least one. Okay. Good. So that's what we can extract from the fact that that we proved last week, that this polynomial does not vanish when its variables have modulus smaller than one. Let's see that it implies what we want for the Diazano contraction. So let's apply that. So Diazano contraction, I remind you, is p hat minus minus zu, or say z, let's forget the u, plus p hat plus plus. Okay, I'm looking now at this particular polynomial. Again, all the other variables are fixed, so these are two fixed coefficients. I have a degree one polynomial in z. Okay, and I want to look when it is equal to z is to zero. So that's equal to zero if and only if z is equal to minus p hat plus plus over p hat minus minus, right? Which means that the modulus of z, which is the modulus of p hat plus plus over the p hat minus minus, has to be at least one, because we have proved that this ratio has modulus at least one. Well, that means that there are no zeros of this polynomial when z has a modulus smaller than one. But this is just p hat e union b, zv, zv is different from zero when all the variables have modulus smaller than one. Okay. And this concludes the proof of this circle theorem. Okay. Good. So this also concludes the chapter on the easing model. We have proved everything we wanted to prove on this model. We determine exactly when, for which values of the parameters beta and h, we have or not first order phase transitions. So now we are going to turn to something which is completely different, which is the Gaussian free field. So it's a model in statistical mechanics that is extremely important. It's very much studied nowadays because it appears in many different contexts, in particular in the study of what happens at critical points, so if you want at beta c in easing type models. But it's also a model which is of interest of its own. For example, it's a model for random surface, as I will explain, and it has been used a lot also for that. So it's chapter 8. Chapter 8 in the book, Gaussian free field. Gaussian free field. Which is usually written GFF. Okay. So it will be the Gaussian free field on ZV, because we are only looking at what happens on the lattice. It admits also a version directly in RD, but we will not discuss it in this class. So let me be rather brief when introducing this model, because the way you construct the model is very similar to what we did for the easing model. So I will be much more succinct than what I did for the easing model. So we'll first describe configurations of this model. So configurations. So now, at each vertex of ZD, ZD, not 2. I mean, 2 is particularly interesting here, but 1D. So at each vertex of the lattice, I will attach a random variable, a spin, you want, exactly as we did in the easing model, except that this spin, instead of taking value plus or minus one, they can take any real value. So the set of configuration will be a set omega, which is just R to the ZD. Okay. The set of, we are attaching a real number to each vertex of ZD. As we did for the easing model, we will often fix the finite set and then consider finite configuration, which will then just be R to the lambda. Okay, that's also something possible. The corresponding random variables, I will denote them instead of sigma as we used for the Ising model, I will use the letter phi, it's more common in this context. I will write phi I for the spin at I. And this is so phi I of omega, omega is an element of this set, is just omega I, exactly as the, in the Ising model. So it's the spin at I, but it's also called the height at I. I will explain why in a second. Okay. Actually, I can explain it immediately. So let's do it this way. So again, I'm on the blackboard, so the picture will be quite low dimensional, but you have to use your imagination to see what happens in higher dimensions. So let's see that this is supposed to represent ZD, what I've written. So it's on the board, it will be D equal 1, but you should imagine ZD. And then in ZD, I have a finite set lambda. Let me denote it like that. So this is the finite set lambda. In Z, it's just an interval. Okay. And then what I represent in the second dimension is the value of the spins. So here, in this direction, I'm representing the value of the spins. Okay, I will not draw them everywhere. Okay. So first, for the spins which are outside the box, say this is maybe vertex k, I will put some height here, which will be a boundary condition, which will be some height eta k. I will introduce all these notations precisely afterwards, but let me first start with a picture. Then if I have an inner vertex I here, the corresponding value here of the field, this is just phi I, the random variable that gives me the height over the vertex I of the spin. Okay. And then I can see I have such a height at each vertex, so maybe let me try to draw something which makes sense. So I have one height for each vertex, and then at the boundary of the box, I will again have some boundary condition, maybe here. And then you can see this as on the board, it will be the graph of a random line. I have a random line here, interpolating linearly between these points. Okay. I have this random line. So it's a random function from ZD to R. And so in dimension 1, it's a random line. Dimension 2, it would be a random surface, and you have generalization in higher dimension. So I will not draw the picture in higher dimension, but you have one for dimension 2 in the book. Okay. So you get a model of random surfaces. So the reason why it's called the height is pretty clear from the picture. So it's really the height over the basis vertex. So the height can be positive or negative, depending on the sign of phi i. Okay. So this you can interpret as a model for random surface. In particular, it can model the behavior of the Ising model. If you take the Ising model, say, for example, the Ising model on Z3, and you take a big box, and you choose as boundary condition pluses on the top half of the box and minuses on the bottom half of the box, then what one can show in this setting is that the plus phase will fill in the top part of the box. Here you will get the plus phase, here you will get the minus phase, and there will be some interfaces separating the two. And when beta is sufficiently close to beta critical, then it's expected that the behavior of this interface in the Ising model should be completely similar to what you have in this model. Okay, so that's one motivation that makes a link with what we saw in chapter 3. Okay, but it's a model which is really of interest by itself. Yes?
Was it proved that the interface was like this, or is it
conjectured? It's conjectured. Yeah, I can say more if you want later, but it's a very difficult problem. The point is that when beta is large, that's not at all what happens. So when the beta is large, you do have an interface, but this interface is completely rigid. It's flat. It's just a perfect plane with just local defects. And what happens is that when beta gets close enough to beta critical, there is a phase transition, which is known as the roughening phase transition, at which this interface starts to delocalize, starts to become unbounded. It will fluctuate to infinity if you take an infinity large system. And in this regime where it starts to fluctuate, it will behave like this. I mean, conjecturally. Okay. Okay, so that's about the configuration. Yes?
Why is it more natural to look at this than to look at, for instance, at a Brownian motion where you would have also increments?
Oh, in dimension one, wouldn't change anything. Dimension two and higher, it's much better behaved. If you want to make a model of a random surface, which is the analog of the Brownian motion dimension one, which is kind of random line, you know, random function from R to R, okay, then things become very difficult. Actually, you cannot define an object like that as a random function. It does not exist with the properties you want. It will be a random distribution. It will be a complete mess. So it's much easier to you have to regularize it in some way. Putting it on a lattice regularizes this. Okay. Then you can take a continuum limit and you will recover this continuum GFF, which is the analog of the Brownian motion to a higher dimensional object.
Okay. Is it in Z2 they are the same?
Or? I'm talking about Z2, yes.
But then they are the same?
The limit will be the same as this continuum GFF, yes. Okay. Yes. Okay. So this is about configuration. Then you remember that once we have configuration, the next step is to define an energy associated to each configuration, so to construct a Hamiltonian for the model. So the Hamiltonian for the GFF is defined as follows. So I'm fixing a finite box in ZD. It will be the Hamiltonian in lambda. Okay. I will write it as follows. It will depend on two parameters. So it will be H lambda. It will depend on beta, which will be the inverse temperature exactly as in the Ising model. And the new parameter that I will call M, which is the mass. Okay. And it's defined by the following expression. You have first a sum over all edges in E lambda B, the same set of edges that we had in the Ising model. So all the edges which intersect all nearest neighbor edges that intersect the box lambda. And then we get phi I minus phi j square. And then we have to put the temperature. It turns out that it's convenient. You will see why later, probably already today, otherwise next week. It's convenient not to put just beta here, but beta over 4D. D is the dimension. The 4D is for convenience, and you will see why it's convenient to do that. And then there is a second term, which involves the mass, which is of the form m squared over 2, and then sum over I in lambda, phi I squared. So that's the Hamiltonian. So intuitively, what are the roles of both terms? So the term which is of the form, the sum of phi m minus phi j square, it tends to favor, so to give a lower energy, so a bigger probability, because remember that the Gibbs measure associates a probability which is proportional to exponential of minus the Hamiltonian. Okay. So the lower the energy, the higher the probability you associate to a particular state, so particular realization. So this term favors configuration phi, which are rather flat. You want all the phi I minus phi j, because it appears with a plus sign and you have a square. So you want all these phi I minus phi j to be as close to zero as possible to get a large weight. So this favors flat configurations. So it prefers flat interfaces. I put quotation marks for a reason that I will explain in a second. It's a bit subtle what this term is doing. And the second thing, the second term, the term which is of the type sum over phi I square, well, to make it small, you have to make all the phi I small. So it favors small heights. So So here I don't need quotation mark because that's exactly what it does, small heights. Okay. So both together, they should favor interfaces that are rather flat and stay close to zero. Okay, we'll see what exactly happens. Now, the reason why I've put quotation mark here is that even if all your phi I minus phi j's are small, look at the one-dimensional picture. Even if you know that all these gradients here are small, that does not mean at all that the interface, say, in the middle of the box takes small values, because you can add many small things. You have a huge number. When you take the big systems, the number of variables, number of gradients that you are adding becomes huge. So even if each of them is very small, when you add them, you can just get a very large value in the middle of the box. Okay? And indeed, what will happen is that when this term is not here, when m is equal to zero, this will not always be enough to localize the interface. And what will happen is that in low dimensions, actually in dimension 1 and 2, the interface will fluctuate up to infinity. In the limit, when the stem becomes infinitely large, the interface will go away to infinity, and the model will not possess a thermodynamic limit. Okay? So without this term in dimension 1 and 2, there is no thermodynamic limit for this model. Yeah. We'll see why I will explain this in this chapter. Okay? So this term is here to regularize. So as soon as it's there, whatever value you put for m, strictly positive, then it will automatically make the thermodynamic limit to exist. Okay, so this is what I wanted to say. So the behavior of the model with m equals zero and the behavior with the model with m different from zero are very different. So they deserve different names, and that's what I'm going to tell you now. Okay, so when m is equal to zero, we say that we are considering the massless Gaussian free field. And when m is positive, we say that we have the massive GFF. And they have very different behaviors. As I said, in dimension 1 and 2, it's even just the fact that the thermodynamic limit does not exist for the massless model, but does exist for the massive. But even in higher dimension, there are very strong differences between the two models that I will explain. Very different behavior. Okay. Okay. So maybe a comment at this stage. So one of my motivations to discuss the GFF in this class, there are several, but one of them is that it's the simplest model that you can analyze that has unbounded spins. So the models we are going to analyze in this class are either models with finite spin, like this model, with just a finite number of values for each at each vertex. So two for this model, finite number for the Potts model, for example, and so on. So this is one class of models. Another class of models to which we will turn in the next chapter are models where the spins take value in a n-dimensional sphere. So, but they will be bounded. It's just they will have norm one, the spins. And the only model where we will have unbounded spins is this one. And it's interesting because when you have unbounded spins, there is some new difficulties that appear that do not appear for bounded spin. So when you have bounded spin, a compactness argument, completely general compactness argument, tells you that you always have a thermodynamic limit. The system, a limiting system, when you let lambda go to infinity, will always exist. You will always be able to construct a Gibbs state for your model when you have a bounded spins by compactness. But once you work with unbounded spin, like here, you lose compactness and you cannot guarantee the existence. In fact, in general, you don't have existence of the limiting infinite volume Gibbs states, and that's the easiest model in which you can discuss these issues. Okay, so that's why I want to discuss it. That's one of the reasons. The other reason is that you can use it to get some insight about what happens for this model where the spins take value in the n-sphere, as I will explain in the next chapter. Okay, so I introduced configuration, the Hamiltonian, now I can introduce the Gibbs measure. So the Gibbs measure in finite box lambda with some boundary condition eta with boundary condition eta given by configuration in omega. So this will be a probability measure as usual. So probability measure. On, well, there are two ways to look at it. Either I can look at it as we did in the Ising model as a probability measure on infinite configurations that are frozen outside a finite set, or I can look at it as a measure of on finite configuration that I extend to the whole of ZD afterwards. It's slightly more convenient to do it this way for this model, so we'll look at it as a model on R to lambda, so which is just omega lambda. Okay. And it's given by the following. So it's R to lambda with the usual Borel sigma algebra, the product sigma algebra. So for any event A in F, the sigma algebra associated to R to the lambda, we associate a probability which will be denoted mu lambda beta m eta. So it's same kind of notation we use for the Ising model. So these are the two parameters that appear in the Hamiltonian. Eta is the boundary condition that I'm fixing outside the box lambda. And the probability of the event A will be given by the integral. So I have to integrate because I have continuous spins now. I cannot sum. I have E minus the Hamiltonian of the configuration. So omega will be the configuration in this set. So it's only specifying the heights inside the box lambda. So I want to extend it to a configuration on the whole of ZD using eta. So I'm using this notation. So omega lambda eta lambda c is a configuration the whole of ZD, which is defined by omega lambda eta lambda c at a vertex I. By definition, it's equal to omega I. If I is in lambda, it's equal to eta I. If I is in ZD minus lambda. Okay. So that's just expansion of minus the Hamiltonian as we had in the Ising model. Then I have to normalize that by a suitable partition function. So it will be Z lambda beta m eta. And then I'm integrating, so I have to give the corresponding reference measure. So it will just be the Lebesgue measure. So I have product of all I in lambda, d omega I. Okay. So these are just Lebesgue measures. The usual volume measure in R to the lambda. Okay. So that's, and of course, it's okay on the event A. Good. Okay. So the partition function, I don't think I have to write it down. It's just what you need, what you take to get something normalized. Right? When you integrate over the whole of omega, you have to, omega lambda, you have to get one. Again. Well, maybe let me still write it. Let's not be lazy. So this is just the integral of E minus H lambda beta and omega lambda eta lambda complement product over I in lambda d omega I. Good. So this gives you the relevant probability measure. Now, let me state an exercise. Well, if I want this definition to make sense, I have to make sure that this quantity is finite. I mean, if the partition function is infinitely large, then I cannot normalize it here. I mean, get something that is meaningless. So you have to make sure that this is a finite quantity. It was trivial that it was a finite quantity for the Ising model. It's not completely trivial. You still have something to check in this case. So for any beta larger than zero, for any m greater or equal to zero, here it's strictly larger than zero, for any boundary condition, the partition function is finite. Okay. So that's first part of the exercise. But if you look, so in the Ising model, if you remember, we introduced the Gibbs measure with eta boundary condition, but we also introduced the Gibbs measure with free boundary condition. If you try to do the same thing here, in the obvious way, so you just put anything outside, you put nothing outside the box lambda, then the partial function is always equal to plus infinity when the mass is not present. So when m is equal to zero, z free, defined the usual way, beta, so zero, is equal to plus infinity, always. Okay, so you cannot make sense of the model, even in finite volume, you cannot make sense of the model of the GFF, massless GFF, with free boundary condition. Does not make any sense. And the reason is pretty clear. So if you look at free boundary condition, that means that you are removing this, you are removing that. It's not anchored anymore, the interface, it's just there. And now you see that if I'm translating upward or downward my interface, the whole interface, so I'm, to each of these heights, I'm adding a constant C, the same constant C to everybody. Okay? That means I'm pushing everybody by a height C, upward or downward, depending on the sign of C. Okay? Then this does not change the energy. The energy is still here, the Hamiltonian is here. If this term is not present, when m is equal to zero, you see that you have only gradients, phi I minus phi j. So if I'm adding C to phi I and C to phi j, the C just disappears. Okay? So this does not change the energy. So the model is completely invariant under all vertical translations, but that's the same thing as trying to construct the uniform measure on R. It does not exist, and you cannot. That's the reason why you will get infinity here when you try to solve this exercise. Okay. Now, last thing I want to say, maybe we first make the break, and then I will say one last thing, and then we'll start analyzing this model. Okay, so I think everybody's back, so we'll start again. The last comment I want to make before starting to investigate this model is the fact that of these two parameters, beta and m, one of the two is irrelevant. I can get rid of one of these two parameters. I will get rid of beta, and I want to explain why. And you can easily see it if you look at the Hamiltonian. So what I can do when I'm looking at the Hamiltonian is that I can rewrite it as minus 1 over 4d, and then there is no minus, so 1 over 4d, and the beta, I can put it inside with the phi, so I get square root beta phi I minus square root beta phi j square. This I can certainly do, it doesn't change anything to the first term. And for the second term, what I can do, I can look at m over square root beta square over 2, sum of square root beta phi I square. Right? Just rewriting my Hamiltonian slightly in such a way that what appears everywhere are, instead of phi I, are square root of beta phi I. Okay. Now these quantities, I can make a change of variable in the integral here, or in the definition of the measure, it's even better here. I can make a change of variable. I can call this phi I now. Okay, just change variable by square root of beta. It's just a very simple change of measure. And if I do that, then I get a new probability measure, which has the following. So first change of variable. So this simple rewriting and change of variables lead to the following, so in the integral. Leads to the following. So I get a new measure, mu eta lambda. So let me write maybe the identity. So that's the old one. This I can write as mu eta prime lambda 1 and m prime of, and this just to make it in the right, square root beta a for any a. For all events, I can have this identity where I have redefined m prime is m over root beta, comes from, we can see it here. Okay. And we get eta prime, which is root beta eta. It just comes from the change of variable that I'm making. So I'm changing the scale on the vertical in the vertical direction. So the height are rescaled by square root beta. This changes also the boundary condition. And that's all, I think. I'm done like that. Okay. So in this way, by making this change of variable, since I'm in any case working with any boundary condition and any mass, I can just call this eta and this m, and I can completely forget about beta because now it's bring down to one. So I can forget about it. So we can forget, can ignore beta from now on, and I will not even write it down in the notation. This will disappear from now on. The measure will just be written mu eta lambda m. Okay. So beta is irrelevant in this problem. It does not change anything. As soon as it's non-zero, it's just as good to put it equal to one. Okay, so that's what I'm gonna do. So these are scaling properties of this model. So it's already a manifestation of the fact that this model is much simpler in many, many respects, much simpler than the Ising model. One reason why it's much simpler than the Ising model is that in the end, it's just a Gaussian measure. The Gibbs measure is just a Gaussian measure. You can see it from the fact that the measure here, so it's of the form, the density with respect to the Lebesgue measure is of the form exponential of minus h, where h is a quadratic function in the phi. So this is clearly a Gaussian probability measure, and Gaussian probability measure, we can compute basically everything we want with them. So everything is explicit. Okay, so it's much simpler than the Ising model. So let me maybe write it down. So mu lambda m eta is a Gaussian measure. So I mean that phi is a Gaussian field. That's why it's called a Gaussian free field, because it's really a Gaussian field. So it's Gaussian. So, and the fact that it's Gaussian means that it's entirely characterized by its mean and by its covariances. Entirely characterized by its mean. So its mean is a vector ui I in zd, where ui is just the expected value of phi I under the measure under the Gibbs measure, just the expected height at the vertex I. Okay. So that's the mean of the field, the expected value of the field. And then its covariance matrix that I will denote G lambda for covariance matrix and mean. I will denote it G lambda for the covariance matrix inside the box lambda. It's given by, say, for any ij in lambda, I have G lambda, it's a matrix, G lambda ij, which is defined as the covariance between phi I and phi j under the Gibbs measure. So let me put eta lambda m to insist on the fact that the covariance is computed with respect to the Gibbs measure mu eta lambda m. Okay. So for any Gaussian measure, it's always the case that if you know the mean and the covariance, you know everything. You can compute everything once you know the mean and the covariance. Okay? And this contains all the information about the measure. So of course, our next step is to try to get explicit formulas for the mean and the covariance of our GFF. Okay? That's what we are going to do now. And the simplest way of doing that is by rewriting this E minus H here in the usual canonical form for a Gaussian measure, that is in the form that I'm going to explain now. So simplest way to determine these quantities, I mean the mean and the covariance matrix, rewrite mu eta lambda m in its canonical form. By which I mean the following. So the density, I will write the density of mu eta lambda m with respect to the Lebesgue measure. I want to rewrite it in the form where it's proportional to exponential of minus 1/2, say omega, omega is, so omega is an element of omega lambda, it's the configuration inside the box, okay? So omega minus the mean, so it's really a vector, right? It's omega I in lambda, u I in lambda, scalar product, the inverse of the covariance matrix, and omega minus u. Okay. Any Gaussian measure I can, okay, any non-singular Gaussian measure I can rewrite it like that. And once I've rewritten it in this form, it's immediate to determine the mean and the covariance matrix because you just read them from the density. If you rewrite it in this form, you will automatically get that this is the mean and that this is the inverse of the inverse of the covariance matrix. So as soon as I'm able to rewrite my quadratic form in such a way, omega minus something times some symmetric matrix times omega minus the same thing, then automatically the two things that I'm subtracting are the mean, and the symmetric matrix is the inverse of the covariance matrix. Okay, so just Gaussian computations. So that's what we are going to do. We are going to compute u and g by rewriting the factor e minus h in a form which is like that. Okay. So let's do it. So it requires some algebra. You have to compute a little bit. But nothing which is not elementary. It's just... just a bit long, but it's really not difficult. It's unfortunately very easy to make a sign, especially a mistake with a sign somewhere. So I hope that I won't make any, but I cannot guarantee it. I will try to check what I'm doing. So H3, harmonic functions, and discrete Green identities. So just tools that I will need, discrete Green identities. Tools that I need to rewrite my Hamiltonian in the proper form. Okay. So now I just do that in a general framework. So I'm getting a vector f, which is just a collection of real number phi I indexed by the vertices of ZD. At the moment, it's completely general. Of course, when I will apply it, it will be to the omega or to the phi I that I had before. Okay. At the moment, it's just a collection of real numbers. I will introduce classical notions that we will need. So there is the discrete gradient, which is defined as follows. So the discrete gradient of f, it depends on edges, nearest neighbor edges, ij. It's defined as fj minus fi. And then you have the discrete Laplacian, Laplacian f is defined on the vertices. And it's given by the sum of all, say, all j neighboring I of gradient f ij. Okay, so that's two objects that will appear all the time. So here I should insist, right? So this is for ij in the edges of ZD, nearest neighbor edges, and that's for any I in ZD. Okay. So the lemma I will need, it's lemma 8-7. with these discrete green identities. So it's the discrete analog of something you know, identities, yes, of something you know very well from geometry, differential geometry. It's the following. So I take a finite subset lambda. I take two collections like that of real numbers. So f is fi, I in zd, and g is gi, I in zd, both in R to the ZD. R to ZD. Okay. And then the first of these are summation by parts formula. So the first one, which I will call DG1, discrete green identity 1, it's telling you the following. So if I'm summing over all edges ij in E lambda B, gradient F ij, gradient G ij, then I would like to take the gradient which is here in front of the G and make an integration by part, so a summation by part because everything is discrete, and bring it here so that I get a Laplacian F. Of course, you know that when you do that, you get a minus sign, integration by part. Okay? And then there will be some boundary term. The difficult thing is to take care of the boundary term. Difficult. The thing where we have to be careful is this one. So I get minus the sum over all I in lambda, GI Laplacian F, I, so that's the term I would like when I've made my integration by my summation by part, and then you get a correction, which is of the following form. So it's the sum over all I in lambda, j not in lambda, I in j neighbor of gj, gradient fij. Okay, that's what you get. So that's the first of these discrete green identities that we'll need.
Excuse me?
Yes.
In the real numbers, like Laplacian is sum of second order derivatives, right?
Yes.
Here is just first order then?
No, because I really have a difference of first order derivative if you look at what I'm doing here. You really have, okay, look at it in dimension one. So I'm summing this gradient and this gradient. This gradient computed with this sign, this gradient computed with this sign. Okay, so I'm really taking the difference between this gradient and this gradient. It's a difference of gradient, so it's second order. Okay, so let me state the second one, and then we'll prove them. Another way of seeing that is second order, write it in terms of f and not gradient of f. So what you get is the usual thing. You will see that the Laplacian is just the sum over all j neighboring I of fj minus 2d fi, something like that. Maybe I get the sign wrong, but I think it's correct like that. Okay. Which is the usual discrete Laplacian for. Or maybe sometimes we put the 1 over 2d here. Just scaling of that. Okay, so that's the first discrete green identity, and the second one that we will also need later is this one. Okay, it's this one, so it's a sum over I in lambda fi Laplacian g I minus gi Laplacian f I. This is equal to the sum over all I in lambda, j not in lambda, I neighboring j, of fj gradient gij minus gj gradient fij. Okay. So these are the two identities I will need. So let's prove that. We prove DG1, and once we've proved the first one, the second one is a one-line consequence. So proof. So in order to have a slightly lighter notation on the blackboard, I will always assume in the proof that when I write J, it's always J neighboring Y. So I will assume AI neighboring J all the time. So we assume everywhere. It will make it will slightly simplify the notations, but it will be already pretty heavy like that. So let's start with this sum here. So we have the sum over all edges in E lambda B, gradient f ij, it's really unpleasant, gradient g ij. Turns out that the fact that this is, it's not completely symmetric, this object, because the vertices which are outside the box play a slightly different role from the vertices which are inside the box, so it's convenient to split this sum into two. I will first sum over all ij's, all the edges which are inside lambda, so always nearest neighbor, I'm assuming nearest neighbor everywhere, of the same thing, gradient f ij, gradient g ij, plus the remaining terms, which are the sum over all, how do I want to write that? So say all I in lambda, j not in lambda, still I neighboring j, still assuming this, gradient f ij, gradient g ij. So I'm just splitting, I'm going to analyze this term. It's the important one, and then we'll see this will contribute to the boundary term that we get here. So let's look at this term. So we have sum over ij in lambda, gradient f ij, gradient g ij. Well, now I'm just using the definition of gradient g. So that's the sum over all ij in lambda, gradient f ij times gj minus gi. Okay, so I get two terms, two sums. Sum over all ij in lambda, gj gradient fij minus sum over all ij in lambda, gi gradient fij. Okay. To now, pretty simple. Now, note that I and j here are just summation variables, so I can just as well rename j, I can call it I, and rename I, call it j. So this is of course the same thing as the sum over all ij in lambda of gi gradient f ji. I have just interchanged the letters that I'm using for the two summation variables. Right? It does not change anything. So this is certainly equal to that. And then the second observation is that this gradient which is here, it's minus, by definition, it's minus the gradient of f, ij. Okay. So what do you get? You get that this term is equal to the sum, or say minus the sum, of gi gradient ij, gradient f ij, which is exactly the term which is here with the same sign. So this term is equal to this term with also a minus sign, so we get minus 2, sum over all ij in lambda, gi, I've kept the second term, gradient f ij. Okay. Good. Now, I want to, instead of summing over edges, I want to sum over the two vertices. So this I can write as minus sum over all I in lambda, gi, sum over all j in lambda, gradient f ij. I don't have the factor 2 anymore because when I sum over I and j like that, I will get twice every edge because I will get ij and ji in the sum, so I will get twice every edge. Okay, so that it's the factor 2. Very good. So now this starts to look very similar to the Laplacian of f, which is here. It was a sum over all gradient fij for all j neighboring I. Here I have all j neighboring I, but only the j's which are inside lambda. So this I want to correct so that I get the Laplacian. So this I can write as Laplacian F evaluated at I minus the sum over all J not in lambda gradient F IJ. Okay, just an identity. Now we are almost done. So let's see what we get. So this gives us minus sum over I in lambda and GI Laplacian F at I. This is good. This is what I want. It's the first term here. And then I get two corrections, this one. And where is it? In this term here. Okay. So, no, not this term here. Where is it? It's I'm too close to the blackboard. I don't see anything. So when I've split this expression into two, what we want is not an expression for this. We want an expression for that. So I must not forget this correction term here. Okay, so let me just finish writing this down. So it's plus sum over I in lambda j not in lambda, again, I neighboring j, gi, gradient f ij. So if I inject this expression for this sum, the expression there, which is equal to this sum, in this decomposition here, I get the following. Sum over all ij in e lambda b, gradient f, ij gradient g ij, this is equal. So we get this expression here, minus sum over I in lambda gi Laplacian f I plus the sum over I in lambda j not in lambda g. Okay, now look at what is here. So you get gi gradient f ij, and from this term I get gradient g ij gradient f ij. So I can put the two terms together and factor out a gradient f ij. So I get gradient f ij, which multiplies, let's say, gradient g ij plus gi. Okay. And we're done because gradient gij plus gi, this is gj minus gi plus gi. So this disappears, and I'm left with the sum over I in lambda, j not in lambda, neighbors, gradient fij, gj, which is exactly the boundary term I claimed here. Okay. So this concludes the proof of this first discrete grain identity. And the second one is just a corollary, which comes from the following observation. So let me rewrite the first Green identity. I get sum over, well, it's just above, but sum over all ij in E lambda b, gradient f ij gradient g ij. This, we said, it's equal to minus the sum over I in lambda gi Laplacian f I plus sum over I in lambda j not in lambda, again, the assumption that they are neighbors, gj gradient f ij. That's what we just proved. Okay. But now observe that this expression here in the left-hand side, it's symmetric in fng. It's completely symmetric in fng. So I can, here the way I've written it is not symmetric in fng. I've decided to take the gradient which is in front of g and push it in front of f, but I could have done the opposite. If I had done the opposite, I would get minus the sum I in lambda, Fi, Laplacian G, I, plus sum over I in lambda, J not in lambda, Fj, gradient G, Ij. I just interchange F and G. Okay. But now it's over. That's discrete green identity too. If you look at the claim here, you get the sum of phi I Laplacian gi minus gi Laplacian fi. It's what you get if you take this guy on the other side. So this first sum, I put it on this side. I get the sum of these two guys. And then this guy, you push it on the other side. And you get this difference here. Okay, it's just a reordering of this identity here. Discrete green identity too. So this concludes the proof of these identities. So nothing difficult, but one has to be careful with the boundary terms. They will play a very crucial role in what will follow. So let me introduce a notation that will be convenient for the SQL. So let's consider the matrix. I want to see now the Laplacian as an operator on ZD, as a matrix, an infinite matrix, delta ij, ij in ZD, ZD times ZD matrix, with element delta ij, which are given by minus 2d if I is equal to j, 1 if I is a neighbor of j, and 0 otherwise. Just introduce this matrix, and then I can rewrite Laplacian f at I can rewrite it as the sum over all j in ZD, delta ij, by fj. Okay, it will be convenient. Okay. Any I in ZD. Then I will also need the restriction of this operator, delta, this Laplacian operator, to the finite set lambda. So the restriction to lambda will just be the operator delta ij, with ij in lambda. But the same delta, the matrix elements are defined the same way, just take the ij in lambda. Okay. Very good. What else should I say? Okay. So now, maybe I try to write it down. I'll explain afterwards. So if you remember, in this canonical form that we want to get in the end, we want a symmetric matrix. We want to have something of the form phi minus u, the inverse of a symmetric matrix, times phi minus u. Right? And this will be a very good candidate, this delta lambda. I should give it a name. So this I will call delta lambda. This restriction is a very good a candidate for this inverse covariance matrix, as we will see in a second. So I need a couple of properties. So the first thing I need is the following. So if I want to be able to compare the Laplacian of f evaluated at I with the Laplacian restricted to lambda of f evaluated at I. So of course that's for I in lambda. I want to compare these two quantities, so they are not equal, there is a correction to add. So if you compare let me maybe write it down. So this delta lambda f at I, this will be by definition of the matrix. So it will be all j in lambda delta ij fj. So if you compare this expression with this expression, is that you are missing all the j's which are neighboring I and which are outside the box lambda. So I need to add the sum over all j not in lambda j neighboring, neighboring I delta ij. Delta ij fj, you can write it like that. But now, by definition of delta, delta ij, if I, here I have only terms where j is neighboring I, so the delta ij when you have neighbors, it's equal to 1. So this is actually always equal to 1 here. So what you get in the end is delta lambda f I plus the sum of all j not in lambda, j neighboring I, fi, fj. Okay, so that's what you get. This we will use. And the last thing I'm going to use is the following notation, which is that I will write f times, that's the idea of getting to this canonical form, so f times delta lambda g. By definition, this will denote the sum over all I in lambda, j in lambda, fi delta ij gj, which is the usual matrix multiplication. Okay. It's clearly, since delta ij is symmetric, it's clearly a symmetric expression, so I also get that this is equal to g scalar product delta lambda f, the same thing. Delta ij is equal to delta ji. Okay. And I think now I have everything I need, so these are the things I will use for the rest of the computation. So let's go back to our Hamiltonian, or at least the general form of the first term in the Hamiltonian, which was this sum of phi I minus phi j square times the constant, but the constant at this stage does not matter. We'll introduce it when needed later. At the moment, it's just the structure that I'm interested in. So assume that you have this collection f equal fi I in ZD, which is compatible now with some boundary condition outside lambda. So compatible with the boundary condition eta, eta and omega, in the sense that fj is equal to eta j for all j not in lambda. So outside the box, I want to freeze, exactly as we did in this example, I want to freeze the values of f to eta outside the box. This will be exactly the eta boundary condition in the application to the Gibbs measure later. Okay? So I really want to freeze the field outside the box to some fixed value. Okay? That's what I'm doing. And now one thing that I have to explain is that when I will start rewriting the Hamiltonian, I will get from time to time terms that only depends on the eta and not on the values of f inside the box. The terms that only depends on the boundary condition, they will appear both when I rewrite e minus h in the numerator of the probability measure, but also when I do exactly the same thing in the partition function. So they will cancel. So these boundary terms, I will explain when we get to this point, but these boundary terms, they will play exactly no role in our computation. They will disappear at some point. So I don't want to keep track of them because it's completely pointless. So I will denote a generic boundary term by B lambda. So let me say that. So all boundary terms, that is depending only on eta j not in lambda, on the boundary condition, and the box, possibly. But not on the values of f inside the box, that's what I mean, will be denoted by a generic B lambda. I will put everything in B lambda. I will not care about what ends up in B lambda. These are really quantities that will disappear, so it's pointless to compute them explicitly. So such terms will play no role. Such terms will cancel and thus play no role. in the sequence. You will see that. But for the moment, just so that you know that I will put everything that depends only on eta in such terms and will not keep track of them. Okay. So let's move to this Hamiltonian. At the moment, I'm only working with the first part of the Hamiltonian, the part which does not involve the mass. The mass will be taken care of later. Okay, so in the Hamiltonian, I get a term of this type. So I have sum over all ij in E lambda b, sum over all edges which intersect the box lambda, of something of the form phi fi minus fj square. Right? There is a multiplicative constant, but I will introduce it later when we really apply it to the Hamiltonian. But the point is that the structure of the first term of the Hamiltonian is of this type. Okay? Now, this, of course, is nothing but the sum over all ij in E lambda b of gradient f ij square. Because that's gradient, I mean, this minus gradient f ij square, so minus disappears, and just get this, right? So to this quantity, I can apply the discrete Green identity with f is equal to g. Okay, so this, by the first discrete Green identity, dg1, that's minus the sum over all I in lambda, fi, Laplacian f, I, and then there was the boundary term, plus sum over all I in lambda, j not in lambda, I in j neighbors, okay, of, and it was fj gradient f ij. That's what you get if you apply the discrete Green identities to this particular sum here. Okay. So this term which is here, I would like to rewrite it in such a way. So for this, I have to make the Laplacian in lambda appear somewhere. So I want to do it at the right time. Is it the right time to do that? No, let's do it, we'll see. So I want to put, here I want to rewrite this as delta lambda f, I, and we saw that delta, so Laplacian f I is delta lambda f I plus this sum. So plus the sum over all I in lambda, j not in lambda, j and I neighbors of fj. So let's see what we get if we do that. So this is equal to, now I get minus the sum of fi delta lambda fi, is just f times delta lambda f, is the notation I introduced here. Okay. Then I get two boundary terms which are summed over the same thing. So I get, let's say, okay, minus, doesn't matter very much. So sum over I in lambda j, not in lambda, I and j neighbors of fj, which comes from here, and here, okay, let's see what we get. So fj minus fj gradient f ij. Okay, I've just taken the second term, so I just get that. And now let's look at what this is really. So this guy here, I can write it, so if I use the fact that gradient fij is fj minus fi, this is fj square minus fj fi. Okay? Now, fj square, j is not in lambda. Okay? J is not in lambda, so fj square is just eta j square. So it's a boundary term, it only depends on eta, depends on nothing. So this will go in my boundary term B lambda. Okay? So what I get, hope I'm not missing something, I just have to be careful. I think I forgot the fi, which is here. Okay, so it's fi fj. That's better. want something quadratic. Fi times Fj. So what do we get? We get minus F times delta lambda F minus, so I get minus Fi Fj I'm not very happy with my sign. So, oh yes, okay, Fi Fj minus minus Fi Fj, this gives me twice Fi Fj with a minus sign, so minus 2, sum over all I in lambda, j not in lambda, I neighboring j, Fi and Fj, plus some boundary term, which contains this Fj square term. So that's where we arrive now. I will steal a couple of minutes because I just want to finish this computation, otherwise it will be completely impossible to understand what's going on next week if I start it from the middle. So, but we're almost done. Now, the term I get here, the expression I get here, so that's basically my Hamiltonian, I get something I'm quite happy with, that's kind of form I want, and then this boundary term, this term here, which I'm not very happy with, this I could not care less about, but this guy I'm not very happy with it. So let's see what we can do. The point is that this is still not the final form I want. What I really want, what we want, is something which is of this form. So I would like to have minus F minus U times delta lambda F minus U plus boundary terms, possibly, okay? With U, which is just a collection UI in ZD, okay? Which depends, it should be the mean, so it should depend only on the boundary condition, only on eta and the shape maybe of the box lambda, okay? But not on the Fi inside the box. That's what I would like to have in the end. I want F minus the means times the inverse of times some symmetric matrix times F minus the mean. So I would like to get something like that, not something like that. So this term, which I'm not very happy with, in some way I have to include it there so that it takes the right form. I want this form in the end. Okay? So in order to see what you should do, it's easier to start from this one and see how you can make it match it with the other one. So let's look at this guy. This guy is equal by linearity. It's equal to minus F times delta lambda F plus 2F times delta lambda U plus or minus U times delta lambda U. Okay, I've just distributed this thing plus boundary terms, okay, which we could not care less about. Okay, now U lambda U. U depends only on eta, so this also boundary term. So this I can forget and I put it in the boundary term. Okay. All this is only depending on the boundary condition. So the relevant part is this one. Now this term is exactly this term. Okay. So I can rewrite this expression, the Hamiltonian, in terms of this quantity with some correction. So let me write it, and then we'll see what we get in the end. E lambda b, fi minus fj square. This is equal to, so I'm looking there, so it's minus f, delta lambda f. So minus f delta lambda f, I can write it as minus f minus u times delta lambda f minus u. I've still not determined u, but you will see how it will come out. Then I have this term that I have to push on the other side. So minus 2f delta lambda u. I have these boundary terms, let me put them here. And then I get this correction here, minus 2 sum over I in lambda, j not in lambda neighbor, I neighboring j of fij. I claim that we are essentially done, so still need to erase one blackboard and then we are done. For the following reason, So let me again, here I want a real Laplacian. So let me write this guy. This I can write as delta u. But if I do that, I have to correct. So I have to subtract the sum of all j not in lambda. When it's evaluated at I, I get delta lambda, delta ui, j neighboring I, and uj. I will get something like that when I make the substitution. So I will get, let me write what we get. We will get minus f minus u, scalar product delta lambda f minus u, that's the first term, which will include also all boundary terms. Then I will get this guy, which I will write explicitly so that you see what happens. So it will be 2, sum over I in lambda, fi, Laplacian ui, which Laplacian in lambda ui, which I replace by Laplacian ui. Okay. And then I get this correction term here, which I will merge with the other one. So I get minus 2, sum over I in lambda, j not in lambda, I and j neighbors. I get fi, fj, so let me see which one I need to keep. Fi, fj. Okay. And then I get this term, correction term, which gives me some fi uj. So I get minus uj. Okay. So this term that I've added, this plus 2 fi uj, it comes from the minus 2 f times this minus uj. Okay, so you get exactly this term. And now, what do I want? In the end, I want this. I would like my Hamiltonian, I would like my sum of fi minus fj squared to be equal to this. So one way to make it equal to this is to choose u in such a way that this is equal to 0 and this is equal to 0. In this case, I would be happy. So we want this to vanish. We want u such that these terms equal 0 for any f compatible with the boundary condition. Okay. So what does it mean? It should be for any f. So for this term, I have no choice. I have to impose that the Laplacian u of at site I is equal to 0. This must be true. For the second term, this must be true for any f. So I have no choice. I have that this difference should be equal to 0. But remember that j is not in lambda. So the fj which is here is actually an eta j. Okay. So what do you get is that u must satisfy then the question is, can you find such a u? Okay, this I will explain next week that you can, but if we want all this to work, u must satisfy the following. It has to satisfy Laplacian u I is equal to 0 at all I in lambda, and it has to satisfy uj is equal to eta j for all j not in lambda. Okay, that's exactly what I had here. This is what I will call dp0 of eta, so it's the massless Dirichlet problem with boundary condition eta. Okay. The first condition here tells you that u is harmonic in lambda. Harmonic in lambda. And the second is just the boundary condition, that u satisfies the boundary condition eta. Okay. So you get a Dirichlet problem, discrete Dirichlet problem, and we will see next week that it has one and only one solution that you can express explicitly in terms of the simple symmetric random walk on ZD. But I will do that next week. Are there questions about the computation we just did? Maybe you got lost because algebra on the blackboard is not optimal, but if you read it carefully again, there is absolutely zero difficulty. There is elementary algebra. Maybe one can easily get lost, but it's really easy. Okay. So see you next week.